Okay, Griff here. Now I'm going to get to the part that a lot of you have been asking for me. This is about bends, and I think for anything that's synonymous with the rock and blues, it has to be bends. So bends, I guess, come from the sound of the steel on strings from the old steel guitar, and from latterly from country music and pedal steel. But anyway, I'm going to sort of teach you in this lesson how to approach some bends and how to kind of strengthen your fingers and how to also get your hands and your ear working together so that what you play sounds tuneful. Now, let's I think stand up for this one. And first of all, stay in A. The simplest bend is to go up one semitone. When you do a bend, so I'm going up this time from B there to C. Now, normally when we're doing a bend, unless it's rapidly executed, we'll put a vibrato on the end of it. I will sort of deal fully with vibrato. I think I will do that in the next lesson, but that is the sort of smallest bend that you can do. There's also a release as well, which is the opposite of a bend, when you start on the note that you would have bent to had you bent upwards and released from there. Sort of a pre-release, which is kind of pretty unique to guitar. So the sort of half tone, the semitone bend, is ideal for our working round our ninths to minor thirds and our sixths to flattened to minor sevenths. Now, a good test for your ear, particularly when you're doing releases and you have to pre-bend, is to play a note, so in this case C up here, and then pre-bend the B up to C and see how close you can get to it. And this is all about feel. The more you do this, the better you'll get it. The good thing is, because we're playing blues, this isn't quite as critical as where you're playing country music, where it's more of a sound emulating the steel pedal steel guitar, and everything has to be super tight in. At least in blues, you've got some. I think the worst sin with blues is to be sharp. Provided you're sort of slightly flat of a note, it's, blues can be quite forgiving. But again, back to this, we're pre-bending the B to get a C. So again, down on the second string, we want to emulate that G there, so we pre-bend the F sharp. It's also quite a nice way. I used to do this a lot to emulate Peter Green's sound. Sometimes it's easier to play a vibrato and get it controlled by using this technique. So if you wanted to play a C with vibrato on it, you actually pre-bend the B up and then put vib on it. It's something I'm pretty positive that Danny Kirwan used on some of the late 60s Fleetwood Mac albums. So for instance, if you take an A up here, play the G sharp below it, pre-bend it up to an A, and then you can play it with a bit of vibrato on it, and you can play a nice tight fast vibrato with that. So let me just demonstrate the technique. I'm not actually aware of anyone else who I'm going to sit down, who uses the technique quite like that, but I like it. It gives a kind of. So there, for instance, to get the F sharp, I'm pre-bending on the F. and just putting a nice vibrato on it. So there, instead of playing the E on the 5th fret, I'm pre-bending on the 4th fret and getting that vib. So welcome to the world of string bending. That's semitone bends. Tone bends are probably more common. This is where you go up two semitones, i.e. a whole tone. And the most common of those is probably bending up the on the second string from the G up to the A. So at the moment, the main thing is to press getting the. Often you'll find it's easier to put one, if you say bending with the second finger, to put the first finger behind it. Or if you're bending with the third finger, put both of the other two behind. Gives it a bit of welly. Personally, I don't bother bending with the fourth finger. I'm sure there are people who do, but it's not a blues technique. Now, the next most common two-note bend is on the third string from our fourth passageway note up to the fifth. So we're bending up for that sound the same as the fifth on the second string. And that's when we start to get that, probably the most famous rock lick of the lot, I think that. It's the Hendrix One Highway Child. So you're starting on the third string, bending up to the A. And this is something that's used in rock and blues a lot, where you bend one note to be the same as another. In this case, we're bending the third string D up to be the same as the E on the second string. Very Led Zeppelin sort of sound. Don't overuse it, but it is a great sound for strengthening. You'll probably see that I'm starting to float around positions a lot more on the guitar now, and I think one of one of the things we're going to have to get into soon is a bit a bit of musical theory, I think, before we go much further, and then we start to talk about some positions on the guitar, and also perhaps a bit more of an elaborate awareness of what we're actually doing when we're playing against chords. The time is not far away now when I'm going to have to sort of pull you away from thinking about the blues scale and for a while concentrate on what we call playing over the changes, which is actually playing the notes that actually relate to the chord you're playing, rather than just playing the blues scale that relates to the bass key of the song that you're playing in. And that really then is the difference between real musician and someone who's just, to be honest, hamming it. So anyway, I think we've done bends, we've done releases. There's really no substitute for practice with this stuff. You'll find it hard, your fingers will hurt. Well, if it's an acoustic, unless you've got an unwound third, don't try this, because you'll only hurt yourself or break the strings. So, it's certainly not a jazz sound, but it's the sound of the blues. Gotta go now.